thank you very much, Mr. President. It's a big happiness for me, and I'm very proud. Yeah. Okay, I will start from my questions. Situation in Syria become more dangerous and more unpredictable. Why? Because this conflict draw inside more participants and more players. For example, who we have now in Syria on the war? Iran, Lebanon, I mean Hezbollah, Russia, Turkey, USA with a big, huge coalition, China show interest. I mean, do you have any concerns that this conflict result in Third World War? Or maybe it's already beginning of Third World War?
If we want to talk about the problem, we have to talk about the crux of the problem, the source of the problem, the terrorism. And no matter who's interfering in Syria now, the most important thing, who's supporting the terrorists on daily basis, every hour, every day. That's the main problem. If we solve that problem, all this complicated image that you described is not a matter. I mean, it's not a big problem. We can solve the problem. So it's not about how many countries interfering now. It's about how many countries supporting the terrorists, because the Russian, Iran, and Hezbollah are our allies, and they came here legally. They support us against the terrorists, while the other countries that you described who are interfering, they are supporting the terrorists. So it's not about the number, it's about the main issue, the terrorism. Second is about the word War III. This term has been used recently a lot, especially after the recent escalation regarding the situation in Syria. I would say what we have now, what we've been seeing recently during the last few weeks and maybe few months, is something like more than Cold War, less than war, a full-blown war. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to call it, but it's not something that has existed recently, because I don't think that the West, and especially United States, has stopped their Cold War even after the collapse of the Soviet Union.
So yes, it's going on.
Yeah, you have many stages in that regard. And Syria, one of these important stages, you see more escalation than before, but the whole issue is about keeping the hegemony of the American around the world, not allowing anyone to be partner on the political or international arena, whether Russia or even their allies in the West. So this is the essence of this war that you describe as Third World War that exists. It is a world war, but it's not military war. Part of it is military, mm-hmm. part of it is terrorism and security, and other part is political. So you're correct, but in different way, not only about Syria. Syria mm-hmm. part of this war.
But you thought Syria became stage of this war.
Yeah.
Why Syria? I mean, okay, you are a big country, I mean, yeah. but you have oil, but not like Saudi Arabia. Why exactly Syria?
It has many aspects. The first one, if you want to talk about the regional conflict, Syria has good relation with Iran. And Saudi Arabia wanted to, let's say, to destroy Iran completely. Maybe in the political sense and maybe in the material sense or factual sense, for different reasons. So they wanted Syria to go against Iran. That's why destroying Syria could affect Iran negatively. That's how we look at it. The West, for them, Syria and Russia are allies for decades now. Mm-hmm. And again, if we undermine the position of Syria, we can influence the Russians negatively. But there's something else. It's about the historical role of Syria. Syria has played that role in the region for centuries. It was always the hub of the geopolitical dynamic in the Middle East. So controlling Syria, since the pharaohs, it's before the Christ, since the pharaohs, they used to fight for Syria, the pharaohs and the Hittites. This is historical basis. So it has a role, geopolitics, the position on the Mediterranean, the society, because Syria is the fault line between the different cultures in mm-hmm. this region. Whatever happens in Syria will influence the region negatively and positively. So controlling Syria is very important. Although Syria is small, it's very important to control the rest of the region. Second, Syria is an independent country. And the West doesn't accept any independent country, whether Syria is a small country or Russia is a great power. What's their problem with Russia? Because you say yes and no. You have to keep saying yes. So that's the problem with the West. So that's why Syria.
Some Western media affirm that the war in Syria now became straight conflict between Russia and USA. You agree with this?
Yeah, for a simple reason. When I said at the very beginning that the issue about the terrorism, Russia wanted to fight terrorism for different reasons, not only for Syria, not only for Russia, for the rest of the region, for Europe, for the rest of the world. They understand what the meaning of terrorism prevailing in certain areas, while the United States have always, since Afghanistan in the early 80s, till this day, they think terrorism is a card you can play. You can put it on the table. You can put it in your pocket and put it on the table anytime. So you're talking about two different entities, two different ideologies, two different behavior, two different approach. That's natural to have this conflict. Even if there's dialogue, they're not on the same page.
Now we have new player in this region. Okay, it was Turkish intervention. And nobody speak about this now, nothing happened. What's your opinion about role of Turkey in this war and about this intervention?
If we start from today, it's invasion.
Invasion.
This incursion is invasion, whether a small part or big, large part of the Syrian territory, is invasion. Against international law, against the moral, against the sovereignty of Syria. But what do the Turks want from this invasion, regardless of the mask that they wear?
Yeah.
To cover their intention, real intentions. They wanted to whitewash their real intention that they used to support ISIS and
Al-Nusra. You think they don't support now?
No, they still support, but they came, they say we are fighting ISIS. We're going
it's
to
ridiculous.
Have...
When they tell, it's ridiculous.
Of
when
course
they tell we are fighting with ISIS, they made ISIS.
Exactly. They made ISIS, they supported ISIS, they give them all the logistical support and allow them to sell our oil through their border, through their territory, with the participations of Erdogan's son and his coterie. All of them were involved in the relation with the ISIS. All the world knows this. But with this invasion, they wanted to change the package of ISIS to talk about the new moderate forces, which are the same grassroots of ISIS. They move it from ISIS. They say ISIS were defeated in some areas because the Turkish bombardment and the troops and their proxies in Syria expelled ISIS from certain areas. It's just a play for the rest of the world. The second one, because he wanted to support Al-Nusra. And he wanted to, Erdogan in particular, wanted to have role in the solution in Syria. It doesn't matter what kind of role. He felt that he's isolated for the last year because of ISIS.
But he still feels like Syria is Ottoman Empire. For him, it's
exactly.
This it's is just his territory.
His ideology is a mixture between the brotherhood ideology, which is violent and extremist, and the Ottoman empire or one sultanate.
Yes.
So I think with these two ideology, he can make a mixture to control this region. That's why he supported the Muslim Brotherhood in every country, including Syria. You're right.
After Russian plane was shot down by the talks, Russia stopped relationships with Turkey. Now, after his excuses, we again. It looked like again friendship, tourism, diplomatic relationships, everything. Putin called this knife in the back when this plane was beaten by the talks. Do you think maybe we Russians make mistake to trust Erdogan again after his betrayal?
No, actually, I look positively to this relation.
You look positively?
Yeah, positively. Why?
Why?
We are talking about two parties. We take into consideration that these two parties they don't see eye to eye. They are in different positions. Russia based its policy on the international law, respecting the sovereignty of other states, and understanding the repercussions of the terrorism prevailing anywhere in the world. While the other party, Turkish party, based his policy on the ideology of Muslim Brotherhood. They don't respect the sovereignty of Syria, and they supported the terrorists. So you can see there's polarization. Each one is in completely the opposite side. So through this rapprochement, let's say, between Russia and Turkey, the only hope that we have as Syria that Russia can make some changes in the Turkish policy. This is our hope. And I'm sure that this is the first goal of the Russian diplomacy toward Turkey these days in order to decrease the damage of the messing up with the Syrian territory by the Turkish government. I hope they can convince them that they have to stop supporting terrorists, stop allowing the flow of terrorists and money for those terrorists through their borders.
But Erdogan, it's this terrorist, it's instrument of influence. He will never refuse from this instrument. It's his people. And if he will try to fight with them, they will start to fight with him. I mean, it's big risk for him to refuse from sponsorship of terrorism. It's big risk for his power.
Yeah, that's why I didn't say the Russian will change his policy. I said they will decrease the damage because somebody who belonged to the Muslim Brotherhood, violent and extremist and fanatic ideology, cannot be a straight person, to be frank and to be realistic. So what you're talking about is very realistic. I agree with you 100%, but at the end, you have to try. You try. If you change 1%, that's good. If you change 10%, then that's good. You don't have to have the full change, and we don't have this hope. We don't raise our expectations a lot, especially with somebody like Erdogan and his clique. But any change in this moment, that will be good. And that this hope that we have, I think, the same that the Russian officials have this time through this relation. And I think this is the wisdom of the movement of the Russian government toward the Turkish government, not because they trust this government, but they need good relation with the people. And that's completely correct.
For me, it's a very strange thing. Daesh, ISIS, with their ideology, never threat Israel. Yeah. And Israel never threat Daesh,
exactly.
ISIS. It's like some kind of agreement about, maybe not on friendship, but neutrality. Why you think it's like this, and what's the role of Israel in this war?
Not only ISIS, not only or Daesh, not only al-Nusra, anyone, any terrorist who held a machine gun and started killing and destroying Syria was supported by Israel, either indirectly through the logistical support on the frontier, or sometimes by direct intervention by Israel against Syria in different area in Syria. Why? Because Israel, our enemy, because they occupy our lands, and they look at Syria as enemy, of course. And for them, they think if they undermine the position of Syria and make it weaker as a whole, as society, as the army, as a state, that will prevent Israel from moving toward the peace. And the price of the peace is to get back the Golan Heights to Syria. So for them, Syria will be busy with another issue now. It won't be busy to talk about the Golan or the peace process, or even to do anything to get back its land. That's why Israel is supporting every terrorist, and there's no contradiction between Israel and any organization like al-Nusra or ISIS or any al-Qaeda link organization.
Your army lost a lot of blood, it's obviously. But from other side, when I sit in Damascus and see in cafe a lot of young people who drink coffee from morning and ask, who are these young men? Why are they not on the front? It's students. After this, I see fitness centers full of young people with very good muscles. What they're doing here? Send them all on front. I mean, I don't understand why you didn't make this general mobilization of army. Like we made this in patriotic war, when we had big war, we sent all men on to front.
Yeah, what we have now is partial, let's say, mobilization. Why partial? Or what meaning of partial? It's not the highest level. The highest level of mobilization means for everyone to go to fight to different military fronts. It means you won't have anyone at the universities, you won't have teachers at schools, you won't have employees to do anything. Even the trucks, the cars will be managed by the government, and anything else that would be part of this war. That would be okay if this war will last for a few weeks or a few months maybe, but for a war that's been there for now nearly 6 years, it means that the paralysis of the society and the paralysis of the state. And you won't win the war if you have paralyzed society. So you need to have balance between the war and between the basic needs of the society, the university, and the services that you should offer to the people. That's why it's crucial to make that balance. So that's our point of view.
But even your TV programs, I don't understand Arabic, but when I watch this, it's like it's peace in country. A little bit from beginning about war, and after this, about sport, about child, children, about schools. I watch this and think, oh my God, in country, I hear how mines explosions in city, like nothing happened. Exactly. Maybe it's too much, maybe people, if you want to push patriotism in people, you must explain them every day. Yeah. Guys, we are in big war. Mm. And that's exactly what every country doing. Yeah. But I don't like this picture of peaceful life. Yeah. It don't exist here.
Our, let's say, media are not disconnected from what's going on, but you need, again, to have the balance between how much you need to have close to natural life, not completely normal life. So you need this balance. Of course, you have many different point of views regarding the media, because media is about the perception. And what you're saying, what you're talking about now, we hear it in Syria. Mm-hmm. How they do this, and if they go too much toward the war, they say, okay, not everything is war. We need to live normal life, or we have to keep life going on. Let's say not normal life, but to keep the life going on. So this balance is not easy. You have different point of view. But at the end, the main challenge, not only the war, the main challenge, how can you live on a daily basis? If you don't try to live this life, the terrorists will defeat you, because that's their aim.
We was living like this when it was great patriotic war. All cities was empty. It was just women, okay, doctors of course, some kind of teachers, but everybody was in the front. Yeah. I will give you example from my family. Four brothers was going to front of my father, and my father left school in 13 years. He was going to factory to make bombs. Yeah. And it was not normal. We would never win this war if we will not put all our men on front.
Yeah, but when you talk about war, not only military, war everything, the most important part of our role, not only terrorists, which is in parallel or as important as it as at the terrorist issue, is the economy. We are under embargo.
So we have
to do our best to keep this wheel moving forward.
I understood.
That's why you need to put all your effort on this life, because without this natural life, you cannot have economy. If everyone wants to stay at home and just live the life of the war, you really don't produce.
Why you ask help of Russia almost in the most critical moment? Almost when everything was crashed and even your life was in danger.
First of all, there's traditional relation between Syria and Russia. And during the worst times of this relation, after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the relation was good. It wasn't bad. It wasn't warm.
That's why you could ask help much more earlier.
We asked the help from the very beginning, but the escalation wasn't as last year. Because before that, the Syrian army was moving forward. And our enemies, let's put it in that term, our enemies, when they saw that we are moving forward on the ground, they started escalating by bringing more terrorists coming from abroad, more foreigners coming from more than 100 countries. At the end, Syria is a small country, and even the population is not very big. So we needed the help of our friends. Iran intervened, and Hezbollah, and Russia as a great power was very crucial in changing the balance of power on the ground. That's why it was natural to ask for the Russian help. They helped us before, maybe not directly through the air forces. They used to send us everything, every logistical support we wanted for that war. But they live with us. We have the military experts living in Syria for decades. They saw on the ground that during that time, in 2014, the balance started changing in favor of the terrorists, with the support of the West and other countries like Saudi Arabia and Turkey and Qatar. And the Russians wanted to, they were ready to intervene directly. That's why we invited them. And because we trust them, of course. We trust their politics based on morals, before interest. We trust them because we know that they wanted to support us because they wanted to get rid of the terrorists, not because they want to ask us anything in return. And they never did. Till this moment, they never asked us for anything in return. All these factors encouraged me and the Syrian government and the institutions to ask for the Russian help.
Before this so-called revolution, I'm sure you got offers from your present enemies, some kind of offers, some kind of deals. Mm. What they wanted from you? I heard, for example, Qatar wanted to make tubes through Syria. Is it true or not? You got some kind of offers before?
The offers started after the crisis. Because they wanted to do the crisis. If you do this, we're going to help you.
Before the crisis, what they wanted from you?
But before the crisis, it wasn't offer. It wasn't, they wanted to use Syria indirectly, not offer. They wanted to convince us to do something. The main issue was, that time, around the world, was the nuclear file of Iran. It was the main issue around the world. And Syria has to convince Iran to go against its interests that time. Mm-hmm. France tried, Saudi Arabia mm-hmm. wanted us to, that time to be away from Iran with no reason, just because they hate Iran. Mm-hmm.
But what about this tube? It's really they wanted to make a gas tube through Syria?
No, they didn't talk about it, but because Syria was supposed to be a hub in that regard of power in general, a tube coming from the East, Iran, Iraq, Syria, Mediterranean, and another one from the Gulf toward Europe. I don't think the West will accept Syria, this Syria, Syria that's not puppet to the West, is not allowed to have this privilege or leverage. It's not allowed. So we think this is one of the factors, but they didn't talk about it directly. After the war, the offer was directly from the Saudi that if you...
Directly from whom?
From the Saudi.
From Saudi. Mm-hmm.
If you move away from Iran and you announce that you disconnect all kind of relations with Iran, we're going to help you. It's very simple and very very straight to the point.
You thought in one of your interviews that this was difficult because it's simple to kill terrorists, but to kill ideology, much more difficult.
Exactly.
And when I was speaking on the front with your officers, they told, look, how to fight with men who is not afraid to die. For him, it's just pleasure to die because 72 virgins wait for him in paradise, yes.
Exactly.
And our people, of course, normal people, they're afraid to die. And already it's moral spirit not the same. Much more higher, terrorists have much more higher moral spirit.
Yes.
How to kill this this ideology?
You're correct. If you talk about those fighters, ideological fighters who are, or terrorists, let's say, who are fighting our army, the only way is to fight them and kill them. You don't have any other way. They're not ready for any dialogue, and you don't have time to make dialogue. You want to protect your citizens, so you have to kill them. But that's not enough. It's like regenerating, like the video games. You keep regenerating anything you want. You kill one, you're going to have another 10. So there's no end to that issue. The most important thing is in the midterm, in the long term, is to fight this ideology through similar but moderate ideology. I mean, you cannot fight extremism in Islam with any other ideology but the moderate Islam. So this is the only, but it takes time. It takes young generation to work on this young generation, to work on the means to suffocate the money that's being paid by the Saudi government and Saudi NGOs and Saudi institutions to promote the Wahhabi ideology around the world. You cannot say, I'm going to fight this ideology, at the same time allowing their sheikhs or imams promoting and their madrasas promoting this dark ideology. It's impossible. And that's what's happening in Europe. You're talking about generation that lived there for generation now, the fourth, third or fourth generation living in Europe, but they send us terrorists from Europe now. They never lived in our region. They don't speak Arabic. Maybe they don't read Quran, but they are extremists because they allow the Wahhabi ideology to infiltrate Europe. So we need to deal with many things. You have to deal with the media, how to deal with their strong media that's been financed by the petrodollar in Saudi Arabia and other Gulf states to promote this extremism. How to deal with it? You need many aspects and many parallel paths at the same time. This is one way you can defeat it. But dealing with the terrorists, this is the last path. And this is the compulsory path. You cannot avoid it, but it's not a solution.
Yes, but I always felt something mystic in this fighting for Damascus. And I understood after why so many mercenaries come here. One professor of theology, Islamic theology, explained me that they really believe in the city Dabiq. It will be an apocalypse. And it's main battle between evil and good. And that's why then they're now already, because I was in Bosnia, for example. Mm. Many mercenaries going through Bosnia, and they all tell, we are going to Dabik. For them, it's mystic meaning.
Exactly.
How to kill this, I cannot imagine.
Exactly.
Because it's big propaganda of this, go to Dabik, go to Syria, because
exactly.
Syria is main place for apocalypse.
A holy place now for the fighting.
Yes, it's a holy place.
If you want to go to paradise, you have to go through Syria. Maybe if you die somewhere else, you won't go to paradise. This is part of the ideology. That's why they...
They are sure if they will die in Syria, they will go straight to paradise?
That's how they think. Yes. And some of them, they think if they kill more innocent, they may have iftar in Ramadan with the Prophet, for example. That's how they believe. They wash their brains completely. So you cannot blame them. They are ignorant. Most of them are teenagers.
Yes.
They've been
children.
Used. Exactly. So, but it's about the machine that's been working for decades now to whitewash these brains and mm-hmm. to spread this extremism around the Muslim world and the Muslim communities outside this Muslim world.
Do you satisfy with results of Russian intervention for this last year? We really made something serious here.
In brief, before that intervention, although there was this American alliance, so-called alliance, which is for me elusive alliance, they did nothing. ISIS was expanding. ISIS and al-Nusra were expanding. They used to have more recruitments. They used to have more oil to export through Turkey and so on. After the Russian interventions, the same land of under the control of the terrorists was shrinking. Mm-hmm. This is in brief. So the reality is telling. Any other effect, I mean, is a trivial. This is the main effect. They mm-hmm. changed the balance on the ground, not in favor of the terrorists.
About Kurdish question, I was in Kamishli, and they want federation. They want to make federation. Yeah. They told our ideal model of state, it's like in Russia. Russia have many nationalities, and they make Russian federation. Why Syria cannot be federation? Yeah. And honestly, nobody from Syrian Kurdish was speaking with me about separation or to make independent state. No, they tell we want to be in Syria, but we want autonomy. You agree with this or not? Because they're really good fighters against ISIS.
Let me clarify the different aspect of this issue. First of all, we cannot talk about community, a full community in Syria, that it wants something, like talking about the Kurds or the Turks or the Arabs or the Chechen or the Armenians or any other mm-hmm. community we have. So we can talk about part of the Kurds that they need this. Part, only part of them. The majority of them, no, they don't ask for it. They never
I don't
ask.
Speak about Kurdish in Damascus. Of course, they live
I
here.
Mean, even in the north, part of them talk about this. This is first. Second, when you talk about federalism or any other similar system, it should be part of the constitution. And the constitution is not owned by the government. The constitution reflects the will of the Syrian people. So if they need to have certain political system in Syria, they need to promote it among the Syrians. They cannot discuss it with me, even if I say, yes, that's a good idea, I don't mind, as president or as official or as government.
It must be referendum, you mean?
I cannot give it to them. It's not. I don't own it. I don't own the political system in Syria. Everything should be...
like referendum.
Exactly, to have mm-hmm. referendum mm-hmm. by the Syrian people to say yes or no. Second, some people, they talk about the Kurdish federalism in the north, regardless of what I talk about most of the Kurdish, that they don't ask for this. Even if you want it, the majority in that area are Arabs. So how can you have Kurdish federalism while you have majority of Arabs?
But you have contacts with them.
Yeah, of course. We have dealing, we have negotiations. We always...
You have negotiations.
Of course, always.
I mean,
and we supported them during the war against ISIS. We sent them armaments, and your army know this all these details.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But honestly, when I was traveling by your country, I don't see any kind of opposition without guns. I mean, with whom with whom you can speak.
Yeah.
You have real partners for negotiations, or it's mission impossible?
This is a very important question, but you have to define the word opposition. Now, most of the world use the word opposition about people who carry guns and kill people. They don't call them opposition. Opposition is a political term. It cannot be a military term.
Yes, exactly. That's the problem, but everybody have guns.
Exactly.
Now,
if we want to talk about political opposition, of course we have.
You have
figures. I don't have names now, but you have figures. You can search for names. You have political currents or political movements.
What are the names of these?
You have new parties. We can get you a name. You have so many. I mean, not all of them are, they don't have seats in the parliaments, for example. But during the crisis, and even before the crisis, you have so many. We can bring you list of all these. We have them. You have new parties who announce themselves as oppositions recently. Again, we can give you a list of all these. If I don't want to mention which name, I can give you the list. But we have them now. But the question here, if you want to make negotiation, that's the crucial point of your question, is not about who I'm going to make negotiations with. The question is about who's influential on the situation, who can change the situation. Now, if I'm going to sit with all these oppositions, whether inside Syria or outside Syria, whether they are real patriotic oppositions, or opposition related to other countries, not to the Syrian people. Let's presume that we are sitting with them and we agreed upon anything. We said this is good for the future of Syria. The question, who's going to influence the terrorists on the ground? We all know that the majority of those terrorists belong to Al-Qaeda affiliated groups, ISIS, Nusra, Ahrar al-Sham, other organizations. They don't belong to any political movement. They don't care about any ideology, but their own ideology, the Wahhabi ideology. Mm-hmm. So even if we negotiate with the political opposition, we cannot change the situation. So that's the most important part of the problem. So you are correct. Who am I going to deal with?
Yes, with whom?
The most important, who's going to change the situation with me? As a government, I have my means. We can change. We are fighting terrorists. What those opposition can do, that's the question. I cannot answer it. They have to answer it. They have to say, we can do this and we can do that. Mm-hmm.
All Western media take information about situation in Syria from this strange organization, Syrian Observatory of Human Rights.
Yeah.
But I understood it's just one man band?
One man living in London.
I don't understand this. I was shocked when I knew. I mean, how they can use this like source of information?
Yeah, because that's what the West wants. They don't need anything real. They need somebody to promote any information that suits their agenda. And they promote it as a real one, as a fact. And as you know now, most of the people in the West are brainwashed regarding what's going on in Syria and maybe in Ukraine. I mean, the same. In Russia, they try to, and they succeeded in brainwashed their public opinion, and this is one of the tools. So it's not the only one. They have many tools, similar tools, like the white helmets recently.
Who are they?
Actually, they work with al-Nusra in the area that's controlled by al-Nusra. How can you work in the same area if you're not under the control of al-Nusra? More importantly, many of their members, there's videos and pictures of them celebrating the death of Syrian army soldiers. They're celebrating on their bodies.
Not long time ago, you mean when America was bombing now Syrian army? You mean this case?
No. In different areas. In Aleppo.
In different areas.
In Aleppo.
Yeah.
In Aleppo, you had a fight, and they pictured themselves over the bodies of Syrian soldiers, the white helmets with al-Nusra. So this is changing of the package of al-Nusra under the title of white helmet, that the good people who are sacrificing their life to help the others and children, and this emotional picture that would affect the public opinion in the
and
West.
And we even don't know from where these pictures.
Sorry?
Nobody knows from where these pictures.
They don't verify anything. It's not important. Now, in the internet, you can find anything. You cannot verify anything on the internet. You just watch. You feel emotional because the picture in Syria should be black and white. The good people versus the bad army or the bad president or bad government or the bad official, let's say. This is the only picture they wanted to have in order to convince their public opinion that we can continue pressuring the Syrian, that they are supporting the good Syrian people against their bad government, and so on. You know this propaganda.
But what will give you liberation of Aleppo in strategic point?
Aleppo, we call it the twin of Damascus for many reasons. It's the second big city in Syria. Mm-hmm. Damascus is the capital, political capital, while actually Aleppo is the industrial capital in Syria.
But no industry now anymore there. Everything crashed.
No, exactly. No, most of the factories in Aleppo, they don't work. They were taken to Turkey.
But if you will take Aleppo, what it will change in war?
Because it's the second city.
Second city, but second what, city. You can cut Anusra from...
First of all, it has political gain, or the strategic level, national gain. Then from the strategic point of view, military point of view, you don't cut. It's going to be the springboard as big city to move to another areas, to liberate another areas from the terrorists. But this is the importance of Aleppo now.
Okay, it's liberation. But what's your next step? How to cut this connection between Turkey and Idlib? Because this is the main source, money, soldiers, everything.
You cannot cut because Idlib is adjacent to Turkey. It's right on the Syrian-Turkish border. Mm-hmm. So you cannot cut. You have to clean. You have to keep cleaning this area and to push the terrorists to Turkey to go back to where they come from or to kill them. There's mm-hmm. no other options. So, Aleppo is going to be very important springboard to do this move.
How many foreign mercenaries passed through your country for the last 5 years, approximately?
No one can count because we don't have regular borders now. They don't mm-hmm. cross the borders regularly, of course. But the estimation through one of the German research centers that was published a few weeks ago, they talk about hundreds of thousands of terrorists.
Hundreds
of thousands. They talk about more than 300,000. Which is,
than 300,000.
Yeah, I don't know if it's correct or not, or precise or not, but if we talk about hundreds of thousands, even if we talk about 100, it's full army.
It's army.
Exactly.
It's whole
That's
army.
Why you keep killing, but you still have recruitment coming from abroad. So you talk about hundreds of thousands coming from different areas in the world. And this is very realistic. You have hundreds of thousands mm-hmm. of terrorists around the world having the same ideology, the Wahhabi ideology. That's mm-hmm. very realistic. This is not exaggeration.
Just for me, I was speaking with your opposition in 2012 in Istanbul with young people who told you want human rights. It was secular, normal people without beard who was, by the way, drinking beer in Ramadan. But just for a few years, they became fanatics.
Yeah.
This is strange for me. And they were completely secular. And who is commanders in Daesh, in ISIS? It's ex-colonels, ex-majors from army of Saddam Hussein. They're secular people
secular.
Too.
Exactly.
How it became army of fanatics?
Yeah.
I don't understand.
Part of it related to what's happened in Iraq after the invasion in 2003, where the American army, or the Americans in general, control everything in Iraq, including the prisons. Mm-hmm. And the leader of ISIS and most of his entourage were in the same prison. So ISIS was created in Iraq under the American supervision.
It was maybe not ISIS's spirit, Al-Qaeda.
No, it was called IS. It wasn't ISIS. It was Islamic State.
Islamic State, okay.
Of Iraq, because mm-hmm. it was in Syria at that time. That's why it was called IS. That was in 2006.
2006?
Six, of course.
And already it was Islamic
course,
State, 2006.
Of course, before the withdrawal of the Americans. That's why they played either direct role or indirect role in creating ISIS. Now, when it comes to Syria, when you talk about the very beginning of the problem, before anybody was talking about al-Nusra or ISIS, they called it Free Army as a secular power fighting... The government and the army. Actually, from the very beginning, if you go back to the internet and you have videos, you have pictures, you have everything, the beheading started from the very first few weeks. So from the very, very beginning, it was extremist movement. But they called it Free Army. But when it becomes bigger and bigger and the beheading couldn't be hidden anymore, they had to confess that there's al-Nusra. Mm-hmm. But actually the same one. Al-Nusra is the same one as Free Syrian Army, the same as ISIS. You have the same grassroots moving from area mm-hmm. to area for different reasons. One of them is the ideology. The other one is out of fear, because if they don't move from place to place, they may kill you. Third one, for the money. ISIS used to give highest salaries for a certain time, 1 year ago, 2 years ago, and before. So many of Al-Nusra and Free Syrian Army joins ISIS for the money. So you have many different factors. But the basics,
but
the same basic, the same foundation of extremism is the common thing between all these different names and organizations.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you a personal question? In 2013, when your life was in so big danger, when America already almost decided to bomb Syria, why didn't you send your family in safe place?
How can you convince the Syrian to stay in their country while you ask your family to leave your country? You cannot. You have to be the first in any term used regarding the patriotic, let's say, headline. You have to be the first as president. You, your family, anyone around you in the government, your staff. You cannot convince the people in your country that you can defend your country while you don't trust your army to defend your family. So that's
the thing. I understood.
That's why it was natural. I never thought about this, actually.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for the interview.